proud of. I'm just kidding, dear. I love you. So I am a senior in the Plastics and Polymer Engineering Technology major here at Penn College. It is the best major. I'm sorry, you guys should have all picked that.
Big facts.
Now, I will get into that later on. I think we all have our place. But yes, I love plastics. If you don't like plastic, please sing afterwards. I'd settle that like men. In the parking lot, yes. Anyways, the next picture down below is my beautiful wife and I on our wedding day. And I've got the cake, and this is about 30 seconds before she tries to smear it in my face, but I devour like a hungry whale. And she gets upset with me because she tried to smear it and it didn't work. And then over here on the right, you can see my beautiful wife again with our son Bartholomew. He's a shark robot statue. His eyes point in opposite directions. He's a little slow, both mentally and physically. He bumps into every wall, so our googly eyes bounce and rattle, but we still love him. And apparently, dear, what was his middle name that you assigned him yesterday?
Eugene.
We had him for 7 months, and he just got his middle name yesterday. Bartholomew Eugene Zechman.
Wow. What a name.
All right, so I wanted to talk to you guys today about glorifying God and doing it through our work. So I want to start off with a show of hands. How many of you love waking up super early in the morning to go work and then coming home at night, barely getting enough sleep, and doing it again the next day? Okay. Thanks for ruining my entire talk, guys. I will see you next week. No, just kidding. So, yeah. As you can see, not many people enjoy doing that. The ones that do, there may be something wrong with you, or maybe you know some secrets that I'm about to tell you later on. Not secrets, it's pretty well known. Sorry. So it says, God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. And God blessed them. And God said to them, be fruitful and multiply. Fill the earth and subdue it. Have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the heavens, and over every living thing that moves on the earth. And God said, behold, I have given you every plant yielding seed that is on the face of the earth, and every tree with seed in its fruit. You shall have them for food. And to every beast of the earth, and to every bird of the heavens, and to everything that creeps on the earth, everything that has breath of life, I have given every green plant for food. And it was so. And God saw that everything he had made, and behold, it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. So, here we see God creating man in his own image, and then gives them instructions to work, saying, be fruitful and multiply. Fill the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and the birds of the air, and the animals, and the beasts, and whatnot. So, this is the first commandment we see of work, but it doesn't seem like very hard work, does it? Saying, hey, Adam, why don't you name these animals and have dominion over them, and just kind of sit back and drink some smoothies with all the raw fruit from one tree, which, you know, we'll learn a little bit more about that later. But anyways, I wanted to direct your attention to the Westminster Shorter Catechism, number one. So Shorter Catechism, or a catechism, is just a statement of faith put together in the form of a question. So these very intelligent men at Westminster looked through the word and they said, hey, why don't we start to state what our faith is in the form of questions? Kind of like Jeopardy, but for theologians. So number one, right away, it hits you with the good stuff, saying, what is the chief end of man, or what is man's ultimate purpose? It's to glorify God and to enjoy him forever. So now we have another command. Obviously, this one is not scripture, but it's based in scripture. It is saying, to glorify God is our job. So, here at the beginning, everything's perfect. Man's instructed to serve God. What an easy task until the fall. So, Genesis 3, if you guys would like to turn there with me. Here in Genesis 3, we see the introduction of sin into the world, where Satan tempts Adam and Eve to break the only command that God gave them, which was not to eat from the tree in the center of the garden. And when they do eat from the tree, it is done in a manner to tickle their pride, to say, hey, you will become like God if you were to do this. And this pride enters into the world, or this sin enters into the world, and causes an unhealthy fear. So in verse 8, and there was the sound of God walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord among the trees of the garden. But when the Lord God called to the man and said to him, where are you? He said, I heard the sound of you in the garden, and I was afraid, because I was naked, and I hid myself. That was 8 through 10, actually, sorry. So yeah, we see an unhealthy fear of God developing here. We also see shame. And then God throws the real curveball and says, later on here in verses 17 through 19, and to Adam he said, because you have listened to the voice of your wife and have eaten from the tree of which I commanded you, you shall not eat of it. Cursed is the ground because of you. In pain you shall eat of it all the days of your life. Thorns and thistles shall bring forth for you, and you shall eat the plants of the field. By the sweat of your face you shall eat bread till you return to the ground, for out of it you were taken, for you are dust, and to dust you shall return. That's joyous, isn't it? So we see an increased toil and work. We also see a spiritual and physical death here in verse 21, which says, verse 21, and the Lord God made for Adam and for his wife garments of skin and clothed them. So right after the sin, we see death introduced. This is the first death ever. God kills an animal, most likely a sheep, we don't know, and makes clothing for them. And this supports, sorry guys, I finished this at like 5 o'clock today. Hebrews 9:22, but it says the remission of sin comes in the form of shed blood. So God sheds the blood of this animal to cover the sins of Adam and Eve, to cover the shame and the fear that Adam and Eve are experiencing. It does not take that sin away yet. They lose life, they gain death, both spiritual and physical, which is pointed out in Romans 3:23. And Romans 6:23. Sorry, I have them all marked with sticky notes. Probably not the best system here. 3:23 says, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Okay, well, yeah, I knew that one. And then 6:23 says, for the wages of sin is death, but for the free gift of God, eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. That's a little bit of a spoiler alert from my next slide here. But either way, we lose or we gain spiritual and physical death, and we also lost perfect communion with God. So in verses 23 to 24, God kicks Adam and Eve out of the garden, places angels at its gates with flaming swords, and says, you are not welcome back into this paradise where you have communion with me. So we now see this long list of unfortunate things that come into the world because of sin. So now, show of hands, who wants to wake up early to work now that you have to toil endlessly? There's death in the world. Let's be Anyways, yeah, so what is the point of work then? Why do we work if it's just toilsome and we eat bread from the sweat of our brow? That's gross. What is the point? Well, the point is found in redemption. So death has redeemed, or has been redeemed, by the work of Jesus Christ. As well as the effects of sin. So not only has Christ redeemed sin in our lives, but he's also redeemed the effects of sin. And that doesn't mean that they all go away. Obviously, you guys know that we still have to work pretty hard. We still see death in the world. We still see a lot of pain in the world. But it means that God can work good out of even these dark things that we know come from sin. And this is only done through his perfect life, his death, and his resurrection of the Son of God, Jesus Christ. Ryan, could you turn the lights on a little bit for someone? Just so I'm going to have someone in the audience, four people in the audience, read. So, can I have a moment to read Romans 5:8? I think that, yeah, that's right. It's a little tough to see. How about 1 Corinthians 15:3-8?
Wait, 3-8 or 3-6?
3-8, I believe.
Okay, it says 3-6 on the red slide.
Oh, yeah. Let me double check and make sure. Well, I checked that. Would someone find John 14:6?
Sarah's got it.
Woo! Okay, thank you. And Hebrews 4:15.
Can I do it?
You have been saved through faith, and this is not of your own doing, it is the gift of God, not as a result of works, so that no one may boast. So it's not that we can do X, Y, and Z for God, and this will come into play later, you'll see, but it's rather that God has offered this gift to us, and now it is just there for us to accept. There's no work to be done. And then John 1. let's look at some of the scripture where they base that off of. First Corinthians 10:31. Do I want to read that one? Joel, thank you. Colossians 3:23-24. And I'll get the last one. So whenever you're ready, Joel.
Yeah, 1 Corinthians 10:31. So whatever you eat or drink or whatever you do, do all to the glory of God.
And whatever you do, do it heartily, as to the Lord, not to men. Knowing that from the Lord you will receive the reward of the inheritance, for you serve the Lord of Christ.
And 3:17. And whatever you do, in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, giving thanks to God the Father through him. So we can see that this calling, this redemption that Christ has offered, or God has offered through Christ, now brings us back and takes work in a full circle, where work is now also being redeemed. Where as we work, no matter where it is, it glorifies God and brings glory back to God. And we're called to do this in everything that we do, especially our work. But what does it mean to glorify God? So, I want to make it very clear here that to glorify God is not to give God something more. God does not need anything more. God is perfectly complete. And if you look back in the beginning of Genesis 1, you can see that God is a triune God. He has three parts even at the beginning of creation. It means that he has perfect harmony. He has everything he could ever need before he even creates us. So the only reason he created us was because he felt like it. And because he wanted to bestow his love upon us. But yet, he could have just bestowed his love upon himself in those other three parts. But I love it. It's what keeps me awake at night, keeps me going during the day. So, just know that we can't offer God anything more, but it is simply just bringing great attention and recognition to something or someone, and in this case, it's God, our perfect God. So I found this awesome quote by John Piper. It says, glorifying means feeling and thinking and acting in ways that reflect his greatness, that make much of God, that give evidence of the supreme greatness of all his attributes and all the all-satisfying beauty of his manifold perfection, or his many perfections. So it's saying that we quite literally just make known and bring to attention how great our God is. Flashback to the 90s song of how great is our God. It's a banger. So, now that we know this, I want to break glorification down into two categories in our work. We have glorification that reaches outward, so it's glorifying and honoring the Lord in our vocations or in our everyday jobs and our tasks. And then we have glorification that reaches inward, which is glorification and honoring of the Lord within the local church. We have reaching out to those that do not know Christ through our work, and we have serving the body of Christ or healing the body of Christ. So, that worked. All right. You have to give it the name Lion clickers. So let's look at vocational glorification. This is done through both deeds and words. You cannot have one without the other. So the first way we can show God glory or give glory to God is through diligent work. Or good work, I think. It's pretty self-explanatory, as we've seen in these verses here. Like Genesis 1, God worked diligently for the first 6 days to create the earth. I mean, think about the water system, like today. You know, we had a big storm, but that replenishes all of the plants and animals on the ground, and then all the excess runs back out into streams and rivers and the ocean. It's evaporated back up, and then peed back down under the ground. And it's just this perfect cycle that sustains life. And even before it started raining, there was just a mist that kept everything hydrated. So God has had all of these things in control, and even the most minute detail, like the smallest bug you can think of. I was going to say tapeworm, but it can actually get pretty big. And then think of the largest animal that you know of, like the blue whale. God created everything in between those. I mean, he even created bacteria. So God, in his 6 days, worked very diligently in order to make a perfect creation. And thus we should mimic it in our work. And then Colossians 3:23 and 24, which I believe we've already read. Yes, Dave, I'm right. Whatever you do, work heartily as for the Lord and not for men, knowing that from the Lord you will receive the inheritance as your reward. Next, we can glorify God through rest. This is my favorite part. So God worked 6 days in the beginning when he created the earth, and then on the seventh day he took a break, he put his feet up, he cracked a soda and watched a baseball game. Creation and thinking, man, we're good at our own. Which may seem selfish, but it's God, so it's not. Anyways, yeah, and then also we're commanded to follow this in Exodus 20, 8 through 11, where God gives the fourth commandment saying, honor the Sabbath, keep it holy, because your God honored the Sabbath. He's holy, so you should be too. And yeah, so this shows our faith and our reliance on the Lord. Back when these decrees were given, you had to go out and harvest your own food. You had to work for your food each and every day. So by not working on that day, you're showing faith in God. You're showing faith and reliance that the Lord will provide for that day you're not working. And we can still do the same today. Next, we can show glory, or we can glorify God through our craftsmanship. So, we can create as he did in Genesis 1. So, how many of you guys in here are going for an engineering degree, or a construction, or major, or any sort of degree where you create things? Yes, thanks, Paul. I see you. Yeah, a lot of us in here. So, we can create things, we can design new things and make things work, and that we can glorify God because he is the ultimate creator. And we can give that glory back to him. He created us, we created this small thing. Or he created a small thing. How many in here are in the physician assistant program, nursing, dental hygiene, or any other human services, or hospitality? Yeah, quite a few, okay. You people, I talked about you like the opposite group. No, I'm just kidding, but not you, Gentile. I don't know why I came out of my mouth. Anyways, you provide service to the needy, just like Christ did in Matthew 8 and 9. He heals a leper. He heals people who were paralyzed. He casts demons out of people. You guys are providing services to the needy. We manage the need well, just like God does in Psalm 23, where David calls God the Good Shepherd and says, you lead me by still waters, so you give me peace while you lead me and direct me and guide me. And then we can be glorifying God by being a good steward of the gifts that he gives us. So he gives each one of us talents. He gives skills. He gives us good, or he gives us finances to glorify him or to honor him with. And that's shown in the parable of the good steward from Matthew 25, 14 through 30. So, those that were at the end of me can probably remember this quote. It's from my own boy, Martin Luther. Also, short or small. Shout out, there's a podcast on Spotify called Luther in Real Time where people act like Martin Luther during the Reformation. It's pretty wicked. I don't know, but they're only like 5 minute episodes and there's maybe 7 or 8 of them, and then when it ends you think there's like 8 more, but it just doubles over and they redo it for some reason. I don't know why. Yeah, a little aggravating, but it's a good podcast. It really teaches you a lot about that period of church history. Anyways, Martin Luther says, the Christian shoemaker does his duty not by putting little crosses on the shoes, but by making good shoes, because God is interested in good craftsmanship. So now we know that we can glorify God through our work, but we also have to glorify him through our speech. Because if we're just working away silently with good work ethic, they're going to be like, wow, he has a great work ethic, which my kid turns out like him, and they're going to go on throughout their day. But if we, in turn, have a good work ethic and we're serving the Lord through deed, and then we accompany it with action or words along with our actions, it becomes evident that the reason we work hard, the reason we meet all of these, or we glorify God in all these manners, is because we are serving the one and only God. So, I've been going through a book called Sent with Noah. Very good book that teaches you how to, not teaches you how, but brings to light some ideas of how we can be serving God in the workplace, not just while we're in college, or not just specifically in ministry. So, some of these tips were, when speaking to coworkers, incorporate spiritual language. Use words like prayer, or scripture, or faith. Yeah, I couldn't remember that last one. Or you can share, sorry, I'm going to double back on that. So these can be seen as setting bait, not in a negative connotation, but just enticing people to learn more. So by saying these words, if they're not accustomed to it, they can ask and say, what do you mean by scripture? What do you mean by faith? What, you know, define that. And then that can lead into an avenue of spiritual conversation where you can share your faith. Next, you can share what you've been learning in Scripture. How many of you guys like a cool tidbit of information? Yeah. Fun fact, polystyrene melts at the exact same temperature boiling water, so sometimes when you stir your coffee, that's why the stick comes out all like twisted and weird. Or like clear plastic spoons, if you put it in boiling water, it'll kind of bend it around and cool shapes with it. It won't hurt. So share some cool tidbits of what you're learning in Scripture, not just what you're learning in classes, or what the word of the day was. Share what you're learning in Scripture, because that is the word or the way that God speaks to us. So, most people don't reject to hearing a cool tidbit of information. They'd love to hear you talk about that, and that can be a great way to start talking about the truths of the Lord. You can pray with or for your coworkers, or both, preferably both. They're having a rough time, pray with them. Say that you're praying for them. Do both. And even if they reject your advance to pray with them, try to pray for them. Just pray that the Lord would soften their heart. That really steps out and shows that not only are you personally acting in a way that honors the Lord, but you would like to share that with someone else too. Then finally, relate ordinary topics to the Lord. How many of you saw the big rainstorm today? What do we often talk about when we meet someone new and we don't know how to break the ice and it's just kind of awkward for standing there? Boy, you see that weather lately? Yeah, it's been chilly. Can't believe it's this cold up to April already, you know? Use that as a pathway into talking about the Lord. You can say, hey, even on these beautiful days, you can see the frost glistening on the grass. And I just think about how cool it is that God created that and gave us this neat beauty. Or think about the way that the sunshine shines through those cold days and warms you up. You know, God created it for red heating, so he knew what he was doing. Pretty cool. Those are some speaking tips when it comes to vocational glorification. And also, I forgot to mention this earlier, but not everyone is called to be a pastor. I feel that's often the pressure that is put. I've felt. Obviously, we're mostly in a trade school, so you might not be feeling that pressure so much either. But we don't have to make a full-time job out of teaching the gospel. Rather, we make teaching the gospel our full-time job, not our part-time job of working for a man. So you don't have to be within the church. You can do this anywhere you want. Also, if you're worried about legality, this doesn't violate freedom of speech. You're not forcing upon anyone. Anyways, so in this, we're also called to glorify God through internal service, like healing or protecting someone's body. Ryan, how healthy is it for someone to eat nothing but potato chips and sit on the couch? Yeah, no exercise. Not healthy at all. By serving in the church, we are protecting, we are working out the body, assisting the body. Sorry, I had to pick up. Anyways, so we're called to serve in the local church. 1 Peter 4:10-11. I'm old So 1 Peter 4:10-11 says, as each has received a gift, use it to serve one another as good stewards of God's varied grace. So we all receive gifts. We're all called to use that to serve one another. Another translation I had said that we're supposed to serve the members of the body. But why? Why are we called to do this? I mean, that's a, I mean, obviously you can see that we're supposed to do it in 1 Peter 4:10-11. Anyways, why are we supposed to do this? It welcomes others into the church, or outsiders into the church. Romans 15:5-7. Together you may with one voice glorify the Lord, for the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, welcome one another as God, or as Christ has welcomed you for the glory of God. So we're called literally to welcome one another. It's a big plug for welcome ministry at any church you're at. We'll talk more about that later. We're also called to do this in order to edify or build up believers within the church. So Ephesians 4:12. Saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ. We also serve in the church to allow ourselves to grow more. So Titus 2 talks about older women or older men pouring into the younger in the church, the younger men and younger women training them up in the ways they're supposed to be. So therefore, serving alongside them helps us grow in our faith and helps us learn more about what we should and shouldn't do, and just to learn more truth about the Lord. And then finally, we do this in order to mimic Christ. Mark 10:45. So Mark 10:45 says, for even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. So, so the church is Christ's bride, and when we complete actions together with our spouse, we draw near to them and we deepen our love for them. So as we are serving, as Christ served, and serving with Christ, that's Christ's second. Either way, when we are serving with Christ and for Christ, we draw closer to him and draw near to him and deepen our love for them, or for him. And in short, we glorify God by serving the church, by tending to his flock, by healing his body, and by welcoming new members by mimicking his actions. Now, if you're like me, your mind is probably racing, saying, that sounds great, I'd love to serve if it wasn't for blank. So I'm gonna take a moment to cut that. You may be saying, I'm too busy, or I'm not here long enough to make a difference in my church or to serve. So you guys are all here to learn something about your location, correct? 2 years is long enough for you to have impact made on you by your professors. So therefore, 2 years minimum is long enough for you to have impact on others in your church for your service. Also, in the parable of the Good Shepherd, we're told to be good shepherds of the gifts that God gives us, and time is a gift. So we're supposed to be using that wisely and being a good steward of our time so that we can make time in order to serve the body. You may be saying, well, I serve with other organizations, so I don't really need to serve in the church. But we are specifically called to go to church and to be part of the church. In Hebrews Hebrews 10:25, where it says, do not neglect meeting, as some do. And this is in conjunction with Titus 2, where it says that we should be part of the church body that has a varying age range. Crew is wonderful, don't get me wrong. I love that you're all here tonight. It's a great way to hear the message of the Lord. But service in crew should not be the end of where we serve. We should also be serving in the church and be active in the church so we can learn more from those outside of our age range, and be teaching those younger than us. And when you teach, you end up learning more that way as well. You may be saying, I don't really know enough people there to serve. I don't feel comfortable doing it because I don't know anyone. Well, we are all saved by Christ, which it says in 1 Corinthians 12:13. We're all saved by Christ. We are all part of one body. And therefore, you have the greatest thing in common with them that you could ever have. And that is salvation in our Lord. So that should be enough to be able to serve alongside them. And the more you serve with them, the more you learn about them as well. You'll become more comfortable. I've made quite a few wonderful friends and learned a lot about many people, more than I thought I'd ever would, in our church, just by holding doors and shaking hands as they come in. And you may be saying, I don't really have the skills to serve. You may say, I'm not good with kids, or I don't like meeting with people. But we serve out of abundance, or out of God's abundance, not out of our own skills, as it says in 1 Peter 4, 10-11. As each has received a gift, use it to serve one another as good stewards of God's varied grace. Whoever speaks, as one who speaks oracles of God. Whoever serves, as one who serves by the strength that God supplies, in order that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. To him belong glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. And finally, you may be thinking, hey, I'm not spiritual enough to serve. You know, I may be new in my faith, but again, you may not have the strongest faith yet, but as you serve, that faith will continue to deepen as you draw near to the Lord. And also, God gives a variety of gifts and skills to each one of us. We may not be called to be a pastor, but you may be called to greet people as they come into the church because you have a nice smile. That doesn't qualify you to greet them. But anyways, you may be qualified to serve or to help in another aspect. As it says in 1 Peter 4:10. In 1 Corinthians 12:4-11. So, I'm going to challenge you guys. Here's a list of some serving opportunities that you can probably find at any church that you guys may attend. Also, if you don't go to a church, you should probably do that. As Nate Lyon says, crew is not the church. We need church outside of crew as well. So, kids ministry. My wife told me to do this. Ladies, how many of you would find an attractive man crew? Coddle a crying baby and make him calm down or change a diaper. A few hands. Thank you for your sincerity. So there you go, man. Now, it's also great practice if you ever plan on being a father someday. It teaches you patience and it just helps serve and helps the mothers in your church be able to learn more about the Lord without having to worry about their child or interfering with others. You can help on the welcome ministry. The welcome ministry is oftentimes the first layer of people that people meet, that new guests meet as they come into the church. And it can oftentimes make or break their experience with the church. So you want to make it feel welcoming. Just as Romans 15:5-7 says that we're supposed to welcome us, everyone else, as Christ has welcomed us. You may want to serve on the worship team. You can play an instrument or you can sing and you'd like to glorify God through song, you can do that. They may need people to fill in or to help in some way, shape, or form. You can serve on the audiovisual team. Those people back there are most likely stressed out because they have to be at church every single week and they have to be in the booth every single week. It's also a great skill to learn. It's pretty cool. I wish I would have learned it sooner, and Andrew's doing a lot better job than I am. You may be able to serve in the men's or women's ministry, even if it's just bringing bacon or scrambled eggs for the morning potluck at 7 a.m., or helping lead one day a book study, or welcoming people over to your apartment in order to have a study. You may be able to help out in the church's young Christ and the church and in earth, or on earth, are necessary. And no matter how glorious or unglorious they may seem, they're all equal. So we can see here in 1 Corinthians